So today's session will be on BAW design in product development. So product development is a separate sector where you become the development part of the product. Like you will not be, you will not be designing, like you will not be a CAD engineer. You will be developing it from scratch. So that is the role of product development in any product or project or in any company. So may it be IT or may it be automotive or may it be banking, whatever it is. When you're into a role called product development, it means that you are going to develop a product from scratch to the customer's end item. Okay. So we'll move further. So as we are speaking about today's topic, we are going to look upon body or what we call it as BIW. So the abbreviation of BIW is body in white. So why are we calling it as body in white? We'll go further in the next slide. So what exactly is an automotive body? Automotive body is nothing but just a sheet metal component or metal component, completely consists of metal components. Everybody used to think that way, right? But it doesn't mean that it consists only of metal components alone. It includes some other plastic components also, which plastic components and some sealer components, which are fluids for some bonding and for extra stiffness as well. So if someone asks you what is an automotive body, don't just say that it is just made of sheet metal. It is more than sheet metal. It includes structural adhesives. It includes plastic strips, adhesive strips. It includes some sealers for welding, specific to welding, and so on. So an automotive body is no more a sheet metal component alone. Okay. So the next point. So what exactly an automotive body accounts in a vehicle? See, the automotive body accounts for almost 25 to 30% of the weight of the entire automotive body, like entire car. Say if you are seeing a car, say for example, XUV700, which we recently launched. So in that car, around 25 to 30% of the entire weight of the car will be made up of BIW, that is body in white. Okay, so this shows that body acts as a major component in a car or an automotive or whatever you say. Even if you take it in a bike, the metal frame of the bike accounts for 25 to 30% of the weight of the bike. So each and every automotive product has a body, and that body accounts for 25 to 30% of its weight. Okay. So here we come. So why do we call it as body in white? There is nothing, some kind of a magic or big thing behind that word. It is because that once a body is assembled in a car manufacturing area, it looks white in color, like approximately white in color. Like you can say like it looks gray or it's silver, but technically speaking, during those days of like more than 70s or 60s, when they started making the first car, they saw the body and suddenly the color which they saw was only white, not gray or silver, which they didn't think of. So they named it as body in white. So as I was saying, the body contributes for the major weight and major safety of the entire vehicle. So now someone has unmuted. Is there something you want to ask? Can I move forward?
Please don't unmute yourself. Don't disturb the session. Please, it's a request from us. Please don't do that. Please don't disturb the session, please.
Okay, thank you. So moving further, so now we know what exactly is a body, what exactly it is made of, and why it is a major component. So now we'll move further. What are the types currently available? Okay, so currently there are two types of body which are mainly used in automotive field. One is body on frame and the other is monocoque. So what are these two types? Say for example, body on frame. So body on frame will have two different pieces of BIW. So one will be called as body and the other will be called as chassis or ladder maybe. So these two major components combined together will form the body, like BIW of this type of vehicle. So these type of body on frame construction are used for very heavy load vehicles like lorries, trucks, buses, vans, minivans, and certain areas they use in car also where they are supposed to use it for heavy loads, like you have a Scorpio, Bolero. So these sort of Mahindra vehicles, they use body on frame construction. So this is done because during any crash or any unavoidable circumstances, the chassis will be the strongest component in this vehicle, which will be bearing maximum amount of load. So this will help to save the heavy load inside the body, the upper body or the shell frame, whatever you see here. So here you're seeing, right? Here we call this as body or shell frame or something. Okay. So this shell frame will not take much of impact. This frame, whatever you're seeing, or the chassis, whatever you're seeing, will be taking maximum impact so that it protects the other load, whichever is inside the shell frame. Okay. So this is the main advantage in the body on frame construction. So monocoque. So what is a monocoque? In monocoque, there will not be two separate pieces of body, like what we saw as a chassis and a shell frame. There will not be two different pieces. Both will be clubbed and will be made as a single piece as BIW, or just a shell frame alone will be available. So in this case, what will happen is the entire front end structure, whatever you're seeing here on that body, will be made highly stiff enough to withstand the loads or the impact loads, whatever we were speaking. Okay. So this will save the whatever the load which is there inside the passenger compartment. The entire load, whichever is coming over from the impact, will be taken by this front end frame and will be delivered through ground. So this is how the construction will be for monocoque. So monocoques, most probably they used for all sedan vehicles and all vehicles, like even now we launched XUV 500, XUV 700. So all these vehicles use monocoque constructions. And especially if you are a good tracker of F1 racings, you will be seeing the F1 race cars, right? So those are all just monocoque constructions. So these are the major types which we are currently using in the automotive industry. So we are moving further. So what are the importance of BIW? So the BIW, as we were speaking, it protects the passengers and other load, whichever is inside the compartment, from crash. So this acts as the mounting for all the other accessories, the trims, be it the seats, the glasses or the front end trims or back end trims, the wheels, tires, and seats, and so on. So whatever accessories you're going to name in the car, it is going to, at the end of the day, it's going to be mounted on the body only. So there is no separate hang or something which is given for any interface. It will be mounted on the body only. The next major important thing is it has to provide space for the passenger, the number of passenger for which it is being launched. Say, for example, you are making a 7-seater vehicle, but as soon as 5 people board the car and the car gets filled. So that doesn't mean it is a 7-seater vehicle, right? So you're supposed to give the space requirement for the number of passengers, what you're at the end of the day, you're going to give to the customer. And the last is it has to protect the customer from the external environment. Why people buy car? They can buy bikes everywhere, right? So they buy car because for some protection, like environment, maybe dust, rain, storm, or whatever it is. So for those sort of environmental protection, the body has to support. Okay, so these will be the important points for the BIW. So we'll move forward. Okay, So now, how does the product development phase works in a automotive industry? Okay, so we are going to see it one by one. So here it will be a little clumsy for you. I'll explain step by step. And in the upcoming slides, I'll be explaining each and every step clearly. Okay. So first of all, when they say we need to make a car in any company, say there's a startup and they want to make a car, which is going to be, they want to make a car. So how do they start it? Say, first, there will be a board meeting where they'll be discussing. Okay. So we are going to make a new project. So what should be that project and which segment of customers are we going to attract? So based on that, they'll be doing a benchmarking. Okay. I want to make a car and it should be a 7-seater vehicle. So whom can we sell a 7-seater vehicle majorly? So it is not only for the family members alone, like say you can sell that to a big family. A family with the 7 members, they can travel in it. So this will be targeting only big families, but it doesn't stop there. Ultimately, when you see the population strategy, how many will be having very big families? Nowadays, the families are shrinking to 3 people in a family. So though, what are you going to do with the 7-seater vehicle? So that is where you target multiple range of customers. The first bucket will be big families. The second bucket will be travel agencies. So they mostly use big vehicles whenever customer book cars. Okay, travel agencies and then other agencies like Ola, Uber, if they are ready to buy the cars, and there are a lot more, right? So this is how they start the activity. So the board of directors will collect these benchmarks. Okay, who are the customers which we are going to target? Then they collect one major people from these customers. Say one person from any big family and one person from like either Ola or Uber and one person from any or the other big travel agency. They bring them together. They will try to understand what are their requirements for that vehicle first. So they will say, we are going to make a 7-seater vehicle. So what will be your requirements in the field? Give us. So based on their inputs, they will be making a strategy. Okay. There will be a travel agency guy who will be saying, sir, the rear luggage compartment is too small. I want it a little bigger so that I can pack a lot of luggage. And the Ola or Uber guy will be saying, sir, the engine is not that sufficient or that efficient enough. We want an engine with a higher mileage. The family person will be saying, sir, I have a very big family. Even though you're launching it for 7-seater, we want seating arrangement such that there will be 10% who can travel in that. So like somewhere we can accommodate space in the seating or something. So these sort of inputs, they'll be taking it and then they'll be going to the designing team or the styling team. So once all the styling, cabin and ergonomic packaging requirements are required, they'll be going to the designing team and this designing team, they will be making only the external look of the car. So they'll be saying how the car should look when it is on the market, how a 7-seater car should look in the market. So this design, this external styling, whatever they are going to give will be based on the viewpoints of the customers and the board of directors of the company. So because the board of directors will have a DNA of design, which they were liking to put it on the car, right? So based on that, they'll be giving the design. So once the concept design is ready, it will be reaching to the design engineers, that is to us, people like us. What we'll be doing, we'll be taking that external styling, we'll be starting to make some plain raw data. So that data will not have any holes or any additional requirements in the panel or anything. It will be just a plain raw surface. So that will be made. So that will be called as concept design. So this concept design will be shared with the interface teams. So what are interface teams? Interface teams are nothing but the other accessories which are going to fit on the body. So once we start the concept design, right? So BIW, that is body design engineers, will be the first point of contact who will be starting the work. So we are supposed to give our data to other interface teams so that they can give their inputs. So based on their inputs, we'll be providing certain small holes, so certain cutouts for their access or other requirements and each and everything. So once this is ready, we'll be making the primary design. So the output coming back from this will be the primary design. So meanwhile, when we are working on these interface inputs and other things, there may be certain points where we'll have to make changes in the styling also. So those sorts of styling changes and other things, we will be sharing with the styling team. And again, the styling will be changing and it will be coming back. So it is a circular loop. So everything here will be a repetitive task. So you can never stop at any particular point. You will be continuously working in any project. Say, for example, the Bolero, which we launched long back, say for around 10 years or 8 years back, we launched Bolero. So still now we are making changes in that Bolero project. So we will never be able to stop designing in any point of time. So designing is a never-ending task. Okay. So you'll be keep on going round and round again and again in all projects. Okay, so that is all. So once the primary design is ready, this primary design will be given for analysis. So the analysis, whatever we are doing, right? So this will be almost 80 to 85% equivalent to the real life load conditions. Okay, the results, whatever we are getting, will be 85% equivalent to the real life conditions. Okay. So based on the CAE analysis, we will be changing the primary design. Okay, so CAE will be saying, okay, this area stiffness is less, this area stiffness is more, I want it reduced. So based on their pros and cons, their inputs, the design will be modified, and this design will be taken confirmation from the interface teams also. Because there may be certain cases where the analysis team will be saying, the cutout what you have given in certain location is too big, because of that the stress is too much. So you'll have to reduce the cutout size. But that cutout would have been given for the interface requirement. So what we'll have to do, once we are making change to the cutout, we are supposed to take confirmation from the interface team whether the change in the size will be okay for them. So once after all the loop is end with the CAE, then we release the secondary data. This secondary data will be going to the manufacturing team. Manufacturing team is nothing but who is going to get the part ready. Say, for example, I am having a bracket. I'll have to manufacture that bracket, right? I am having the design. I'll have to manufacture it physically. So that is the thing. We'll give it to the manufacturing team. So now the manufacturing team will take the design of the bracket. They will be simulating it in their own softwares for simulation. They'll be taking the outputs. These outputs are then analyzed, and based on their input, again, the secondary design will be modified. So they may say that the bracket is not manufacturable in a particular location. The part is getting torn off in that location. So there is more thinning in that location. So all sort of comments will be coming. So based on that, we'll have to modify the part again. So based on this modification, again, we'll have to loop it through CAE, and again, we'll have to loop it through interface team. So we'll have to take the concurrence of these two people for the modification, whatever we are doing for manufacturing requirement. So once this is done, we'll be releasing the tertiary data or the third cut data. So this third cut data will be going to the assembly team. Okay. So now once the design is ready, CAE is cleared, interface team is cleared, manufacturing is cleared. Okay. We have all the parts manufactured and ready. What is the next step? We are supposed to put those parts together into one single piece so that we get a car out, right? So we need to next look on to the assembly team. So this designs will be taken by the assembly team and they will be analyzing it from their point of view. Okay. So if we are putting these parts into the fixture, where it is hitting in the fixture and where it is hitting with the tools for assembly. So each and everything they will analyze and they will come back with their feedback stating that, okay, the cutout what you have given here is too small. We want it a little bigger so that we'll be able to use our tool to access for joinery and so on. So based on their input, again, the design will be modified. And again, the concurrence from all these three teams, manufacturing, CAE and interface team has to be taken. So once all this are cleared, then we release the final design. Ultimately, there is nothing called as final design, but this is something which we will release for the production. So once the production design is released, the drafting team will be generating the drawings with the 3D model, whatever we have made. So based on this drawing, the manufacturing team and the assembly team, they will be going for trials. Okay. So once the first cut trials are taken, there will be certain feedbacks from there. There will be some interface team saying that in design it is like this and in the physical it is coming smaller. So you need to increase the hole size. And assembly team will be coming and saying this area, the design, it is small and here it is very big. So you have to reduce the cutout. The manufacturing team will say the part in design and in simulation, it cleared. But in manufacturing simulation also it cleared, but in physical it is getting torn off. So you'll have to modify a certain location. So all these feedbacks will be taken and it will be modified in the final design, which we released. And finally, we'll be releasing a good to go design for the final production. So this is when the final production will start. So once after the final production, what will happen? Okay, we have launched the car. That's all. Ho gaya kaam, khatam ho gaya, rest karo abhi. SNI, it will not go like that way. So all you'll have to do is you'll be again working on that project. So that it the project, like you'll be again working on final design, whatever you have released for production or whatever it is. Or sometimes there may be some styling changes again coming in that product, which will be starting the loop again from the first. So it depends. So it's based on the customer field requirements as well as the higher authority requirements in the organization. So it is a never-ending task and it will never end at all. Okay. So this is the basic structure of the automotive like whatever department you say, either it be BIW or other interface teams. So this will be the basic structure of working, how they work. Okay. So now we are going to break down each and every step and see what exactly it is. Okay. So what is a styling data? So styling data is the starting point of any vehicle project, may it be bike, car or aeroplane or rocket or whatever it is. So there will be certain aesthetic points that they will be seeing on that product. So this styling data defines the aesthetic point of customers. Okay. So as I said, once the board of directors has decided that this should be the styling and this should be the number of seaters and this should be the size of the car, everything, those inputs will be given to the styling team and they will be making a styling data. The styling data will be something like this only, which will be very raw and vague. So they'll be making it in the styling studios using some holographic images and holograms. And the basic software which they use in industry for styling is Alias. They call it as Alias. Okay. So this is the process where it starts. So once the styling is defined, next it goes for concept design. So once the styling is completed, it comes to the designers like us. We are supposed to develop the in parts based on that styling. What are all the requirements of the vehicle? What will be the crash requirements of the vehicle? What will be the interface requirements of the vehicle? Each and ergonomic requirements of the vehicle, each and everything has to be taken into account. And based on that, the each and every part required for that product should be made from scratch. Okay. So once we are designing, there will be certain inputs we will be giving to the styling team that this area, the design is not possible because of certain constraints. We will not be able to do certain process over in certain location. So the styling has to be changed in those locations. So those sort of inputs can be given to the styling. And if possible, the styling will be modified. So after concept, interface. So what are the interfaces in a car? So there are a lot more interfaces. Nowadays, due to the use of electronics and other sensors and so on, there are even more interfaces coming in the cars. The major interfaces are interior trims, exterior trims, chassis, transmission, glass. So here you can ask, sir, chassis, you said it will be a part of body. So, but here you are putting chassis as an interface. Of course, chassis is an interface only because chassis is a sheet metal component and it is a part of the entire body. But ultimately, at the end of the day, this chassis somehow has to get fitted to the body, right? So ultimately, when you see it from the perspective of body, chassis is an interface. So that is the reason I have listed chassis as an interface point. Okay. So all these interfaces has to come and sit in the vehicle. In the vehicle, what we are going to design, right? So if you see in a single automotive body, there will be more than thousands of interface parts which will be coming and sitting. Okay. So all these thousand parts has to come and get fit in the body. So that is the reason each and every modification in the product, we take concurrence from the interface team, whether it's okay for them or not. So next will be the CAE. So CAE part is nothing but we'll be analyzing the vehicle virtually before making it physically. In olden days, like in 60s and 70s, the vehicles were not too fast. They were too slow and the accidents were very less. So what they used to do is they used to make some physical car and they used to crash it and they used to hit it and check it. But nowadays, the cars are moving too fast. The life is moving too fast. We have upgraded a lot. So because of this, what happens? The fatality using automobiles are higher. So in order to counter that, we will not be able to crash the vehicles at that speed. Like we will not be able to make physical vehicles and crash and check each and every time, right? We'll incur a huge loss. So that is the reason we go for CAE analysis so that we reduce the cost of physical validations. So once this CAE is done, then we make some prototype vehicles of that model and then we check crashing it physically. So that is how we move. So here in CAE, what they do is they check for the DVP, design verification procedure. Say, for example, if you are going to make an SUV and it is going to be a 7-seater, there will be certain amount of test conditions which you are supposed to clear so that you can launch that vehicle and you can produce that vehicle and you can sell that vehicle. Okay. So what there are a lot of design verification procedures like that. So this design verification procedures will vary from segment to segment and from country to country. Okay. So if you see, there are full frontal impact, oil canning, side crash, offset frontal impact, hood slam, and a lot more. Okay. Whatever I have listed are some major requirements. There are other minor requirements. Okay. These DVPs are specific to body only. There are multiple DVs for each and every component in a vehicle. Say for a screw, if you're taking, there are 5 major DVPs which a screw has to clear so that it can be used in this car. If you take an electrical wire, the electrical wire has to clear 3 major DVPs so that it can be used in a car. So like that, each and every single component used in a car has its own specific DVPs which it is supposed to clear. Okay, so once this DVP is done, we'll be moving forward for manufacturing. So like what we do, we create the design and we analyze in our analysis software. Similarly, the manufacturing team who are taking our design will be analyzing in their perspective. We'll be putting it in their analysis software like AutoForm and so on. Okay. Say for example, the major concept designing softwares which they use in industry now are NX, CAD, and CATIA, majorly CATIA, and all industries are now moving towards CATIA. Okay. So concept design happens in CATIA software. I forgot to say that point. And CAE, the major used softwares are Hypermesh, Ansys, and what else? They use Abacus. So these are the major softwares which they use in the industry. And for manufacturing, so for manufacturing or for die or sheet metal designing, they use Autoform, one of the major software which they use for analyzing their designs. Okay. So once we give our design, what they do is they take this design, they put it in the Autoform software, and they check whether the part could be formed in the sheet metal. So here, wherever you're seeing this red area, right? It means that the part is tearing over in that area. Okay. So here, wherever you see violet, there is no impact in that area. So like this. So they will be analyzing whether the part is manufacturable with the size of the blank what we are giving and the shape whatever we are in need. Okay. So each and everything they'll be analyzing. So the major thing that they check is the thinning, the part thinning we call. Say what is thinning? Thinning is a point where, say for example, we are giving a sheet metal of thickness 0.7 for a part. Okay. But in the CAD design, the thickness will be 0.7 in all the locations. But when it comes to the physical part, the thickness at the stretched areas or in the filleted areas or in the chamfered areas, the thickness will reduce further. That proportion of reduction is called thinning. So what is the actual thickness and what is the reduced thickness and how much it has reduced? That percentage is called thinning. And this percentage should not go less than 5%. If it is going less than 5% in the sense, then the part is for sure not manufacturable. So whatever is required to bring the part manufacturable is that this thinning has to be brought above 5%. Okay. The major processes in making a sheet metal part is blanking, piercing, trimming, and these are the operations which they do. Okay. These will be taken in detail maybe in another session or something, if they have something on. Okay. Next. So once manufacturing is done, assembly. So what an assembly team does, the assembly team takes care of the assembling process of the parts, whatever we have manufactured. So they'll have to check how to put it on the fixture, how to clamp it on the fixture, how to use the tools, spot welding gun or the nut runners or sealer guns or robot has to take its axis. So each and everything they will be analyzing on the software. So where it is taking interference, so where it has to be cleared, where they need some access cutouts for taking welds or applying sealers or so on. So each and everything they will be checking and they will be giving their inputs. So there are a lot of operations which are done on BAW. One is we are supposed to put it on the fixture. Second, we are supposed to apply some sealers as per requirement. The third thing is we'll have to put another part over it and clamp that part also. And there are other conditions like spot welding, CO2 welding, robotic welding, hemming. So all these operations has to be taken care of by the assembly team during assemblies. Okay. So they'll be checking feasibility for all these operations. So once this is done, everything is done, we will be going for the final design. As I said, there is no such thing called as final design. We will be releasing for production. So once after production, again, we'll be revisiting those products. Okay, for other like weight reduction, cost reduction, like performance improvement. So there are certain things where we'll be getting to know in physical validation, like noise, some noises coming from some location or some area they'll not be able to spot weld it. So those sort of improvements have to be done during production. There will be like a running change. So they will be made, these changes will be made during production itself, and they will be immediately implemented. So this is how the final design goes further. Okay. So finally, we'll be closing with a quotation. So when you don't have an additional skill, you will be a choice for the employer. But when you have a lot of skills, you can choose among the employers. Okay, so whatever you're doing now, whatever you people are here for, is nothing but applies for the last line of the code. You're skilling up yourself so that you can choose among the employers. Okay, all the best, guys.
Thank you very much, Mr. Balaji. So I just wanted, you know, before students ask the question, I just wanted to know what will be your suggestion for the people who are willing to get into any particular department field, or maybe it's maybe automotive, or maybe, you know, robotics, or maybe designing. So what is your suggestion to them for graduate who are under, I mean, in colleges, and who and those who have already graduated but not getting a job? Yeah. So what would you advise them?
So the first thing is, never get disheartened that you haven't got an opportunity. Okay. Your opportunity is waiting for you, and that is the reason you have not got it. Okay. The second thing is, you'll have to be curious to know each and everything. You might have studied in automobile, like mechanical engineering or something, but you need to be curious even on the programming side also. So if you consider me, I'm from a mechatronics background. I'm into the field of automotive BAW design, but yet I'm still creating softwares for my own company in my own department. So this doesn't mean that I have studied mechatronics, I'm working in automotive, but I'm creating software. I am trying to learn. I'm trying to be curious on everything. So when you're curious on something, the opportunity which you were awaiting will come to you at that point of time only. So you'll have to be curious on everything. Start growing up your skills. So try to make physical skills a lot, like hands-on. I mean to say physical means it's hands-on skill. Like may it be a software, may it be a programming language, or may it be a, say for example, speech. Like you give public speaking or whatever it is, make it hands-on. Make it a daily routine, so that you will be always in touch with it. Okay. So once you do these two things, you will be easily into whatever your goal is.